financial services and low and moderate income households, and researches and writes about a wide range of issues in financial regulation. Professor Barr previously served as Treasury Secretary Robert Rubin's Special Assistant and Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Treasury. Professor Anthony Sanders. Professor Sanders is a professor of finance and real estate at the W.P. Carey College of Business of Arizona State University, where he holds the Bob Herberger Arizona Heritage Chair. He's previously taught at the University of Chicago, Graduate School of Business, University of Texas at Austin, Macomb School of Business, Ohio State University, Fisher College of Business. In addition, he served as director and head of asset-backed and mortgage-backed securities research at Deutsche Bank in New York City. He has served as a consultant to various firms such as Merrill Lynch, UBS, Bank of Scotland, Nationwide Insurance, and Deutsche Bank on a subject of mortgage design, mortgage-backed securities, and commercial mortgage-backed securities, loan servicing, and risk management. Ms. Alice Cohen, staff attorney, Ms. Elise Cohen, is a staff attorney at the National Consumer Law Center, where she focuses on home ownership and other low-income consumer credit issues. She's contributing author of The Cost of Credit and Truth in Lending Manuals, provides training on consumer law to attorneys and other advocates, and participates in NCLC's advocacy efforts. Prior to joining the NCLC staff, Elise worked as an attorney in the Federal Trade Commission's Bureau of Consumer Protection, Division of Financial Practices, where she specialized in credit discrimination and high-cost lending issues. Mr. Larry Litton, or Lighton? Litton is the President and Chief Executive Officer of Litton Loan Servicing, overseeing the day-to-day operation of Litton's $75 billion mortgage servicing portfolio. As a founding member of the company, Mr. Litton has been involved in every aspect of the business since its inception in 1988, with more than 20 years of experience in mortgage servicing. He's considered an expert in the field of credit-sensitive mortgage loans, was appointed and served on the Mortgage Bankers Association, Residential Board of Governors, Board of Directors of the Texas Mortgage Bankers, and served on the State of Ohio Foreclosure Prevention Task Force. Mr. Stephen Kundenholt, is that right? Did I pronounce that right? Okay. Mr. Stephen Kundenholt serves as chairman of the Structured Finance Practice Group at the law firm of Thatcher, Prophet & Wood, based in New York, a leader in residential mortgage loan securitization. His areas of practice include residential and commercial mortgage-backed securities and other asset-backed securities, primarily focusing on residential mortgage loan securitization as well as resecuritization transactions involving various classes of mortgage-backed securities. Mr. Kundenholt has helped develop many transaction structures and formats that have become industry standards, including shifting interest subordination techniques. Mr. Thomas Deutsch. Is that right, Deutsch? Mr. Deutsch is Deputy Director of the American Securitization Forum, the leading trade organization of all parties to mortgage-backed securities. Prior to joining the American Securitization Forum, Mr. Deutsch held the position of Associate in the Capital Markets Department of Cadwallader, Wickersham & Taft, LLP, where he represented issuers and underwriters in various structured finance offerings, including residential mortgage-backed securitizations and credit card securitizations. Prior to Cadwallader, Wickersham & Taft, LLP, Mr. Deutsch was an associate at McKee Nelson, LLP, where he focused on residential mortgage-backed securitizations. So this is a panel of experts, and we appreciate their presence here. And I would inform the witnesses, as I did the last witness, that it is the policy of the Committee on Oversight and Government Reform to swear in all the witnesses before you testify. I would ask that each of you rise. Please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you very much. Let the record reflect that each and every witness has answered in the affirmative. Now, as with panel one, I'm going to ask that each witness give an oral summary of your testimony. I would ask you to keep this summary to about 5 minutes in duration. Your complete statement will be in a written record. And we do this in order to have a little bit more time for Q&A and interact. Professor Barr, let's proceed with you. And I want to thank you for your presence here. And I want to thank you for your patience, too. The questioning of the first witness, as you might expect, went an extended period of time. But, you know, we know that your time is valuable as well. And thank you for your patience. Please, Professor Barr, you may proceed.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Issa, and distinguished members of the committee. It's my honor to be here today to testify about Treasury's progress in preventing foreclosures. There's bipartisan agreement today that stemming the tide of foreclosures and restructuring troubled mortgages would slow the downward spiral harming financial institutions and the real American economy. The federal government has a range of authorities to take action, but what has been missing is a way to get servicers who control most of these loans on behalf of mortgage-backed securities investors to restructure the loans themselves or sell the loans to the Treasury at a discount so they can be modified. To date, Treasury's efforts have largely failed. Owing a duty to countless investors with conflicting interests, servicers have largely been paralyzed by a fear of liability, restrictive tax and accounting rules, and the wrong financial incentives. Instead of restructuring loans, most servicers are foreclosing at alarming rates, as you have seen yourselves in your own communities. As I'll explain further in a moment, what we need now is new legislation to unlock the securitization trusts so that servicers can modify loans or sell them to Treasury at a steep discount. Treasury can then restructure those loans, include a shared equity feature to protect taxpayers, issue new guarantees on the restructured loans along the lines that the ranking member has suggested, and selling them back into the market. This would help homeowners and restore liquidity and stability to our markets. In the meanwhile, the administration can act now. They should use a full court press to help troubled homeowners. They should stabilize our financial markets, jumpstart our economy. In particular, Treasury can guarantee home mortgages held in trusts and in portfolios in exchange for real restructuring. They can pay servicers to restructure loans as well. Treasury can contract with the FDIC to implement a restructuring program, enlist Fannie and Freddie, and bolster FHA. Let me talk about this in a little bit more detail. After nearly a year of hoping that the private sector would stem foreclosures, and then a hurried series of weeks lurching from bailout to bankruptcy and back to bailout again, Treasury finally declared that the time had come for congressional authorization of a program, the Troubled Asset Relief Program, with the dominant rationale that Treasury would buy tranches of securities and collateralized debt obligations in order to jumpstart credit markets. But the administration's proposal left intact the conflicts of interest and legal barriers blocking real home mortgage structuring. Moreover, the administration's rationales for the program shifted significantly between proposal and enactment. And after enactment, the administration put on the back burner its plans to buy mortgage-backed securities, instead focusing on capital injections, hoping that banks would increase their lending. Instead, capital has been deployed largely to shore up the capital base against further decline in asset values, as well as the committee noted to engage in merger and acquisition activity. And new capital has gone to AIG as well. Just this week, Treasury announced formally what we already knew. It had abandoned the idea of buying troubled assets under the Troubled Asset Relief Program. Despite the limitations of the approach taken by the administration such far, the Emergency Economic Stabilization Act potential is significant. Under Section 109 of the Act, the Treasury Secretary is authorized to use loan guarantees. Under Section 101 of the Act, the Secretary is authorized to make and fund commitments to purchase troubled assets, including home mortgage loans. These authorities can be deployed now to help homeowners. Here's how. First, guarantee home mortgages in exchange for real restructuring. Treasury can offer to guarantee troubled loans held by servicers if they modify troubled loans to bring debt-to-income ratios in line with prudent underwriting and sustain affordability. Second, pay servicers. Right now, trusts pay servicers for the extra work of foreclosing on homes, but largely not for modifications. Treasury could pay servicers to make loan modifications that meet Treasury guidelines. Third, let the FDIC act now. The FDIC has led the way in seeking to end this crisis, as you know, and has put forward a plan for guaranteeing troubled loans. Treasury could just say yes. Bolster the FHA in need of real resources. Enlist Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac beyond the announcement Tuesday that largely reflected existing practice. Private label securitizations, not the GSEs, however, hold most of the troubled subprime and Alt-A mortgages. We need to find a way to unlock those pools. Here's how. There's a three-part plan. First, preserve REMIC tax benefits. Servicers managing pools of loans are generally barred from selling the underlying mortgage loans, but the trust agreements provide that servicers must amend the agreements if doing so would be helpful or necessary to maintain real estate mortgage investment conduit status. These rules provide important benefits for the trust. Through a legislative fix, we can effectively require the trust to change their practices. Second, indemnification of servicers. We can, excuse me, Mr. Chairman, I notice my time is up. May I finish?
Sure.
Thank you. We should indemnify servicers. Legislation could provide a narrowly tailored indemnification of servicers who reasonably pursue loan modifications or sales under Treasury programs. And third, we need to provide legal certainty under accounting standards. Because selling home mortgage loans to Treasury would advance important public interests and not conflict with the underlying purposes of Statement 140, the Financial Accounting Standards Board should modify the statement to provide servicers with legal comfort in broadly modifying and selling mortgage loans under Treasury's programs. Until we provide real home mortgage relief, our economy is going to continue its vicious downward spiral of foreclosures, home price implosions, credit illiquidity, and decline. We need to end the crisis now.
I thank the gentleman. Professor Sanders, you may proceed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, member of the committee, thank you for the invitation to testify before you today. Housing prices in many areas of the United States have slowed or declined dramatically over the past 2 years. This decline is partly responsible for the large increase in subprime mortgage delinquencies over the same period. According to Hope Now Alliance survey data, 14.4% of subprime mortgages are 60 days or more delinquent over the third quarter of 2008, and while 2.3% of prime mortgages are 60% or over delinquent in the same period, that rate has almost doubled from the third quarter of 2007 at 1.26%. From the third quarter of 2007 to the third quarter of 2008, there were many, many, many foreclosure sales, of which over half were subprime borrowers. But as Adam Smith's invisible hand, we used to term it as, that's been replaced by the invisible foot, where homeowners are being booted out of their houses at record rates. We are in the midst of a subprime meltdown and a second wave of Alt-A, the low documentation mortgage arms and related mortgages, and those are beginning to reset. Therefore, it is of critical importance to find ways to slow down the delinquency and foreclosure waves if economically viable. This urgency is reflected in the announcement by the Federal Housing Finance Agency on Wednesday that Fannie and Freddie announced accelerating their loan modification activities. While Secretary Paulson has announced that TARP will not be used to purchase troubled loans from banks, it is still of tantamount importance to stabilize the housing and mortgage markets, and loan modifications are one of the best tools available to Treasury, even if they decide in the short run not to deploy them. Hopefully, the acceleration of loan modifications by Fannie and Freddie will help stabilize the market, but it is a dangerous strategy to rely on the banking system when clogged to jam pipes, particularly when with an overwhelmed servicing industry. And once again, it is important to note that Fannie and Freddie, while Congressman Cummings pointed out maybe 70% of the loans are being touched by Fannie and Freddie, that is more the low-hanging fruit. We are not talking about the whole loans, subprime, and Alt-A that are really the source of the problem in the housing market in the United States. There are several loan modifications that are currently being employed by loan servicers. These include loan rate reductions, loan rate freezes, amortization period extensions, and principal reductions. While the first two are the most common, principal reductions have been much less so. In fact, only Ocwen currently has been a major force with approximately 70% of the total principal modifications done to date. According to Credit Suisse, the average balance decline for first lien principal modifications is approximately 20% and 55% for second lien principal modifications. As housing prices begin to fall and number of borrowers experience negative equity continues rising, the demand for such modifications is growing. Principal modifications serve to reduce the monthly payments and reduce negative equity. Thus, principal modifications should increase the willingness of borrowers to stay in the home. Loan modifications may help keep borrowers in their home and increase the probability that they will be able to cure their delinquency. Foreclosure involves multiple transaction costs, including legal filings and selling expenses that can reach almost 50% loss severity on each loan. said during the current housing and mortgage crisis, the capacity of loan servicers to process additional foreclosures has been limited, resulting in an increase in the effective cost to cure delinquencies and a reduction in the number of households that have been able to obtain a modification. In summary, preventative principal reductions can actually serve to stave off defaults and help stabilize the housing and mortgage market. Waiting until the borrower goes 60 to 90 days delinquent is dangerous, since the longer a servicer waits to modify the loan, the more likely the loan is to go into default, generating enormous costs for the lenders and servicers. Thus, loan modifications are not a bailout of borrowers per se. Rather, it is an attempt to reduce costs to lenders and investors while at the same time preserving home ownership and reducing systemic risk in the economy. Thank you for your willingness to let me share my thoughts with you.
And, Ms. Cohen, you may proceed.
Chairman Kucinich, Ranking Member Issa, thank you for inviting me to testify at today's hearing on the Treasury Department's TARP program. On a daily basis, the National Consumer Law Center's attorneys provide legal and technical assistance on consumer law issues to legal services, government, and private attorneys representing low-income consumers across the country. From this vantage point, we are seeing the devastating effects of escalating foreclosures on families and communities. There is no doubt bold and immediate action is needed to save homes and neighborhoods. Treasury's recent announcement makes clear, however, that stopping foreclosures and saving homes and neighborhoods is not a priority of the current TARP program. We appreciate the FDIC's announcement today on the use of the TARP guarantee program. Such a plan would be a substantial step in the right direction. Congress must insist that Treasury use the broad powers provided by TARP to mandate affordable modifications through every means available. Only such a plan will get at the root cause of this entire crisis, defaults and foreclosures engineered by overreaching mortgage loan originators and investors, and thus stabilize the housing market. To the extent Treasury provides funds to firms providing non-mortgage credit, there should be a quid pro quo for reforming mass abuses in those industries, including auto finance, private student loans, and credit cards. On mortgages, Treasury should develop a loan modification program that can be routinized and applied on a large-scale basis. It should condition any purchase of an equity interest in a financial institution on a rigorous loan modification plan. It should provide guarantees only for affordable loan modifications, and it should purchase a sufficient stake in assets to enable the implementation of an aggressive modification program through the purchase of whole loans, second mortgages, securities, or servicing rights. An effective TARP program for homeowners lies in the mechanics of its loan modification program. The following principles should apply to such a program. 1. A mechanized program of affordable and sustainable modifications is essential to process the many homeowners facing foreclosure. 2. The affordability analysis in any loan modification program must be both objective and have a safety valve for homeowners in special situations. 3. Loan modifications should include principal reductions to 95% LTV, so borrowers are invested in long-term homeownership and so they can refinance to make needed repairs, obtain a reverse mortgage, or relocate. 4. Second liens should be bought out at a nominal price. Without addressing second liens, a program can go nowhere. 5. Loan modifications should be available to homeowners in default as well as for those for whom default is reasonably foreseeable. 6. Late fees and all default servicing fees should always be waived in loan modifications. As servicers profit enormously from such fees, they often are out of proportion to the loan balance. 7. Any shared loss guarantee should favor the most needed loan modifications. And 8. Loan modifications should not cost servicers more to do than foreclosures. In addition, Congress should pass legislation to allow loan modifications through bankruptcy, reform the servicing industry by requiring loss mitigation prior to any foreclosure, and remove tax consequences for loan modifications. Why do we need these measures? While the servicing industry stands at the center of the foreclosure crisis and thus is in the best position to turn the situation around, the basic structure of the servicing business requires us to recognize we cannot leave it to this industry to lead the way out of the foreclosure nightmare. Even the streamlined modification program is limited in terms and has been announced, by private sector servicing firms that have a dismal record of providing efficient and fair service. In the interest of maximizing profits, servicers have engaged in a laundry list of bad behavior, which has considerably exacerbated foreclosure rates, including cascading fees imposed upon homeowners in default. Servicers profit from levying fees and keeping borrowers in the sweatbox of default, contrary to the interests of homeowners and investors. While clarifying a servicer's duty to the entire investor pool and allowing for clear decision-making capacity by servicers will help, more substantial intervention will be needed to rescue homeowners from a broken system that works against their interests. Thank you for the opportunity to testify before the committee today. A strong loan modification program under TARP is essential, as is passage of legislation to allow for loan modifications in bankruptcy, to reform the servicing industry, and to address the tax consequences of loan modifications. Thank you. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Mr. Litton.
Yes, sir. Mr. Chairman, I just want to thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today. I am responsible for running a mortgage servicing company that's right on the front lines of this crisis. We service 450,000 loans.
Hold on. Is the microphone on now?
Okay, great.
Yeah, we want to make sure.
I talked so loud I wasn't able to hear myself anyway through the mic.
You know, when I was in the city council in Cleveland years ago, my mic used to get cut off, and I learned to talk loud as well. But here they need to pick up the sound of your voice.
There you go. Well, thank you for your
patience. We all set now on tech side here? Okay, good.
And to top it off, I even have a cold today, so.
Well, thank you for being here. Go ahead.
I would like to thank you again for the opportunity to address the committee. I run a mortgage loan servicing company that services 450,000 loans totaling about $75 billion of product. I was asked here today to provide some insight into the performance of loan modifications and to explore additional ways that servicers can help homeowners stay in their homes during these very difficult times. As a servicer, we are the intermediary between investors in mortgage loans and mortgage-backed securities as well as homeowners. Servicers perform a host of duties. We are responsible for collecting monthly payments from the customer. We're responsible for forwarding those payments on to the investor. We handle taxes, insurance, as well as other things. We are also responsible for working with delinquent customers, and we're also responsible for creating workout opportunities and modifying those loans when we can do so. Litton has been a strong proponent of responsible loan modifications since my father founded the company in 1988. And I'm very proud to say, by the way, that I'm still working with my dad 20 years later. As a servicer, we not only have a contractual obligation to our investors, but we also have a responsibility to provide options that give homeowners a second chance. In the past year, we have observed several notable trends that are presenting increased challenges to servicers as well as homeowners. First of all, default rates have increased and have continued to do so at an accelerated rate. Second, redefault rates on loans that have been previously modified have gone up and are going up and at an accelerating rate. Third, fewer customers are accepting the loan modifications that were being offered, including pre-approved streamlined loan modifications. Fourth, foreclosures on vacant properties have doubled from this time last year. And finally, our customers are facing tremendous economic headwinds driven by higher instances of job loss, wage compression, and a host of other economic issues. It's clear to me that we as a servicing industry need to continue to be even more aggressive than we have been with modifying loan terms and finding new ways to get homeowners' payments down even further than we've done already. We believe that this is good both for homeowners and communities, and it's also good for investors whose loans we are servicing. Over the past 12 months, I'm proud to say that we've modified more than 41,000 loans. That represents 12% of our portfolio, and that represents 38% of loans that were 60 days or more past due. Whenever we modify a loan, we consider all of the following approaches. We will write down principal. We'll waive part or all of the arrearage that has accrued on the loan. We'll look at decreasing the interest rate, and we'll also look at extending the term. However, despite that work, despite all the loan modifications we have done, we have not seen an appreciable decline or any decline whatsoever in new foreclosure starts over this same period. In response to this, it's clear to me as an asset manager responsible for 450,000 mortgage loans that we've got to do more. And the more that we're doing is we have implemented at Lytton a new debt-to-income standard of 31% on our loan modifications. Our belief is that using this standard will allow us to do more loan modifications and provide greater payment relief to borrowers and provide a more long-term sustainable solution. We believe that our investors will benefit tremendously from this, and we're confident that we'll be able to demonstrate that by decreasing future default rates. Thank you, Chairman, for the opportunity to address the committee, and I look forward to answering additional questions that you may have.
I thank the gentleman, Mr. Kuttenholt.
Chairman Kucinich, thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today. My name is Steve Kuttenholt. I'm the head of the Structured Finance Practice Group at the law firm of Thatcher Prophet, based in New York.
Could you please pull that mic a little bit closer?
Certainly, sir. Could. Since the credit crisis began last year, our firm has worked closely with the American Securitization Forum and other industry participants to improve awareness about the flexibility in existing securitization structures to perform loan modifications. In today's environment, residential mortgage loan servicers need to be able to use all possible tools to minimize losses and foreclosures. My comments will focus on how TARP or other programs could be used to increase loan modifications and reduce foreclosures in the context of residential loans included in private label securitizations, non-GSE securitizations. Most private label securitization governing documents give broad authority to the servicer to service loans in accordance with customary standards and in a manner that is in the best interests of investors. Many securitization governing documents specifically authorize loan modifications where the loan is in default or where default is reasonably foreseeable. ESA Section 109A provides that the Secretary may use loan guarantees and credit enhancements to facilitate loan modifications to prevent avoidable foreclosures. If a guarantee program were created that covered specific loans that had been modified, this could result in more modifications. Under a typical loan modification program, the servicer takes the following steps. First, a specific proposed loan modification is designed based on the borrower's current ability to pay. Second, the anticipated payment stream from that loan as modified is compared with the anticipated recovery from foreclosure on a net present value basis. And then third, the servicer chooses the alternative with the greater NPV. Now, in comparing a loan modification with a foreclosure, the servicer applies an assumed redefault rate, and this factor reduces the NPV of the modification alternative. But if credit support were added that eliminated that redefault risk, then the servicer would be more likely to be able to choose the modification over foreclosure, as long as the cost of the guarantee was less than the reduction in NPV that would have resulted from the redefault risk. In order to encourage modifications and protect the taxpayer's interests, such a guarantee program should be limited to servicers who have demonstrated that they have a robust and systematic modification program with sufficient staffing and resources to handle a high volume of modifications. The program should include procedures to verify current income and should include a reliable model for calculating NPV. We think a program of this type could actually change servicer behavior without creating a mandate or changing the operative documents. Another possibility would be to develop a program under TARP whereby defaulted mortgage loans could be purchased directly from securitization trusts at a discounted price. Such a program would be very helpful because there are borrowers who will default, who would like to stay in the home, but would not be able to qualify for a loan modification because they could not document current sufficient income, and they may not be eligible for the Help for Homeowners program either. Defaulted loans purchased under this program would be subject to a wider range of workout options, such as potentially renting the property back to the borrower. Although typical servicing authority provisions have been broadly interpreted to allow loan modifications, these provisions to date have not been interpreted to allow such sales for a number of reasons, primarily because FAS 140 does not permit sales of loans out of securitization trusts. However, most securitization documents are actually silent on whether defaulted loans can be sold for a discounted price. Where they are silent, we think there's a strong argument that such sales could be made if the loan was in default and if the cash price resulting from the sale was greater than the NPV of a recovery under foreclosure. And the servicer safe harbor provisions that were added under Section 119 of ESA would support this interpretation. However, an essential element of this type of program would be an authoritative change or clarification of FAS 140 to permit sales without adverse accounting consequences. These two programs would potentially offer additional tools to a servicer to mitigate losses and prevent foreclosures that they do not have today.
I thank the gentleman, Mr. Deutsch. You may proceed.
Chairman Kucinich, my name is Tom Deutsch, and I'm the Deputy Executive Director of the American Securitization Forum. I very much appreciate the opportunity to testify before this committee on behalf of the more than 330 member institutions of the American Securitization Forum, including mortgage lenders, servicers, and institutional investors, regarding how the securitization industry and the federal government can work together to prevent avoidable foreclosures under the new Emergency Economic Stabilization Act. I testify here today with one simple overarching message. Industry participants have been and will continue to deploy aggressive and streamlined efforts to prevent as many avoidable foreclosures as possible. But let me also repeat the statement that you quoted earlier today, is that macroeconomic forces bearing down on an already troubled housing market are simply too strong for private sector loan modification initiatives alone to counteract the systematic risks imposed by nationwide increase in mortgage defaults and foreclosures. In my testimony here today, I look to outline a number of ways that the industry and the government can work together under TARP to target relief to troubled homeowners while simultaneously helping to restore credit to mortgage borrowers. Economic and housing market conditions have clearly deteriorated over the last 18 months, and that deterioration has intensified recently. Job losses, declining home values, and borrowers' extraordinary non-mortgage consumer debts have combined to put severe strain on homeowners and drive rising delinquencies, defaults, and foreclosures. Given these unprecedented challenges, servicers have responded with unprecedented efforts, as no securitization market constituency, lenders, servicers, or investors benefits from loan defaults or foreclosures. As a result, the number of loan modifications, for example, has increased by over six times the rate at which they were being provided to borrowers at this time last year. One driving force behind this exponential increase was the streamlined framework the American Securitization Forum developed last year that all major servicers have implemented to provide efficient loan modification decisions to subprime ARM borrowers facing interest rate resets. In an effort to expand this framework, we are actively reviewing criteria from other streamlined loan modification approaches that have recently been announced, such as the plan implemented by the FDIC at IndyMac and the Federal Housing Finance Agency protocol announced on Wednesday. Ultimately, though, we must all recognize the seismic economic challenges in the United States, the epicenter of which is in the housing market, are too great for purely private sector loan modification solutions. As such, evolving private sector loan modification activities, though playing an important part of the solution, have limits to their effectiveness in addressing the extraordinary challenges in the housing market and should not be seen as a panacea for all housing market ills. As such, we believe expanded voluntary government programs under TARP would be very effective in bridging the gap to address the potential foreclosures that commercial and contractual obligations cannot prevent. The newly enacted TARP contains significant opportunity for federal government to use guarantees to incentivize additional loan modifications for distressed borrowers. In particular, the Act specifically authorizes that the Secretary may use loan guarantees and credit enhancements to facilitate loan modifications to prevent avoidable foreclosures. We believe there have been some positive general approaches put forth, for example, by the chairman of the FDIC that would have the federal government, through TARP, provide credit guarantees for redefaults on modified loans that would substantially increase the number of loan modifications granted and ultimately foreclosures avoided. But the details of the program, such as that which was announced this morning, are very important. Issues like DTI and LTV requirements are thoroughly under review by our members as we speak to evaluate the program and to see about the next steps the ASF may be able to take. Since the TARP program announced, there continues to be a great deal of discussion, much of which has occurred today, regarding what assets the program would purchase and how that ownership would give the federal government control over the servicing of those assets. If whole loans were purchased by TARP directly from the banks, for example, the government would have complete discretion to apply its own loss mitigation and loan modification protocols to those loans. But if the TARP program were to buy mortgage-backed securities in whole, their ability to exercise control over servicing policy to effectuate their own loan modifications would be limited unless the program purchased a supermajority of each outstanding class of each note in the trust. Given that there is currently $7.5 trillion of securitized mortgage debt outstanding in the United States, which is slightly more than half of the $14.8 trillion of mortgage debt outstanding, a third opportunity for TARP should be explored. That is, in this time of extraordinary housing market dislocation, it may be appropriate for the industry, accounting standard setters, and tax officials to reevaluate the ability of servicers to be able to sell individual distressed loans out of mortgage-backed securities pools to TARP, which could give the Treasury Department unlimited discretion to modify those loans under whatever protocol they think appropriate. Currently, mortgage loan servicers generally do not have the legal ability to sell distressed loans out of mortgage securities. I would note that it's critical that these programs remain voluntary. As we've noted and as we've heard today, one of the primary objectives of TARP is to restore credit availability to mortgage and consumer assets throughout the country. Anything other than voluntary could greatly put that at risk and further entrench the credit crisis. I thank you very much for the opportunity to testify here today and look forward to answering any questions that you may have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deutsch. I just want to say to each and every member of the panel, thank you for your very thoughtful, analytical presentations. I've had the chance to read your testimony, and based on the urgency of this moment, I'm going to ask staff to work together to provide members of Congress with the testimony that was given today. We really need to do that. When members come back next week, we need to get to them this testimony from these individuals. Because what we're looking at here is a way forward. That's, Mr. Rice, I just mentioned that it's so important to for members of Congress to look at this perspective that's been offered, which is really a way out of where we are right now, and that I've asked staff to work together to communicate this to the members of Congress. So we're going to have the first round of questions, 10 minutes, and I'm going to begin. I'd like to just go down the line of witnesses with the same question. You know, each of you had the opportunity to sit through the lengthy questioning of Mr. Kashkari, and I'm sure that you've also are very familiar with Mr. Paulson's announcement 2 days ago that the TARP would not buy troubled mortgage assets. What was your reaction to Mr. Paulson's statement about how he views the use of the troubled asset relief program at this point?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think it's quite troubling that the administration has decided not to use the authority that the Congress gave to the Treasury for the purpose of helping homeowners. I think it's a significant policy error. And I think it has enormous negative consequences for our country. So I was quite disturbed by it. I'm hopeful that Congress can work with the administration in its remaining weeks to reverse that decision. And I'm hopeful that the new administration would take a different approach. I think we need to have a systematic effort to restructure troubled mortgages. It sounds like many of the panelists agree that a program of guarantees, a program of purchase, changes in tax and accounting rules are in order to unlock the trust and help our country move forward.
Thank you very much. Professor Sanders.
Thank you, Congressman Kucinich. I just wanted to go on record and say that I was kind of startled by the decision to cancel the loan repurchase part of TARP for the simple reason is this, is that what's causing the problem with banks are failed loans. The failed loans are costing the banks enormous amounts of money, which means that they can no longer meet their capital. So what do? We give them checks for more capital in the form of preferred stock, however you want to do it. So in other words, we didn't get to the root cause of the problem. We simply treated what the outcome was, like a rash. I mean, it's very severe, and I don't mean to downplay that. Having banks fail was a horrible thing. But if they're not making loans to anybody, kind of why are we doing this is number one. But number two, in terms of the repurchases, as I'm trying to we really have to do something, and I agree with everyone on this panel more or less has said, we have to become much more aggressive or assertive in how we're going to modify some of these loans because we have another wave coming and we are going to get swamped by business as usual. So I'm just pleading with Congress and the incoming administration to take some bold steps because we're going to be underwater severely.
That's a point that members of the committee have made, and we appreciate you making it. Ms. Cohen, for your assessment of the Treasury Secretary's announcement.
Well, your question reminds me of that weekend back in September when we saw the first draft of the TARP legislation coming out of Treasury. The purposes of the Act then were only to help banks and not to help homeowners, and folks had to fight very hard to get the rights of homeowners in. And so in some ways it's not surprising that the vision of the Treasury Department and the administration is not different now from what it was then. In their view, it's all about liquidity, and on Main Street it's really about homes and neighborhoods. So it's a huge disappointment, and I agree with the other panelists that it needs to be turned around.
As we go to Mr. Litton, I just want to say that I appreciate the relationship that you have with the East Side Organizing Project in Cleveland, Ohio.
Yes, sir.
Where you have worked to complete modifications, and from our understanding, there's been it's been a model of success in these troubled times. More success than we've seen in other areas. So I just wanted to point that out and ask you for your assessment of Mr. Paulson's pronouncement relative to your, the work that you're doing right now and trying to do.
So as it relates to that announcement, as a servicer in the trenches every day, servicing loans that are in mortgage-backed securities, it doesn't impact me as directly on a day-to-day basis because we can't sell the assets anyway on a one-off basis, as these gentlemen had previously indicated. What does become more clear to me, and Mr. Chairman, I think that you hit on a great point a moment ago with your acknowledgement of the work that we do with ESOP, is that the borrowers that I deal with every day cannot afford the mortgages that they're in, and we're re-underwriting them on loan modifications to standards that do not produce long-term affordable mortgages. To me, that's the simple, fundamental realization as a guy that's trying to work with these consumers on a day-to-day basis that we have to be more effective at coming out with a lower debt-to-income standard, and we have to be more reasonable as it relates to writing principal off and right-sizing these balances if we're going to put a stop to the downward spiral on what's going on with home prices. So anything that we can do that helps me get that objective accomplished, I think, is a good thing. Anything that gets in the way of getting that objective accomplished, I think, is ultimately a bad thing.
Thank you. Mr. Kuttenhalt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think I could understand why large-scale purchases of residential mortgage-backed securities in and of themselves would not necessarily reduce foreclosures or would not necessarily enable the government to cause those pools to service the loans differently, because it's very difficult to get control over a pool by purchasing classes, and as Mr. Deutsch mentioned, it's extremely difficult, considered impossible really, to amend a governing document to change the rules. But as I talked about in my testimony, the existing rules of these securitization documents do permit a wide array of options for the servicer in mitigating losses, and the existing provisions do support the types of modification programs that the panel has talked about today. Now, the two programs that I talked about, which could be done through TARP or through the FDIC or another government program, namely a guarantee program and a purchasing individual defaulted loans out of pools program. These could actually change servicer behavior. They could change outcomes. They would result in a fewer number of loans going into foreclosure. And I think incrementally they could certainly make improvements.
Thank you. And finally, Mr. Deutsch, your comments on Mr. Paulson's announcement relative to the Troubled Asset Relief Program.
I think one of the primary objectives of TARP at the beginning and continues to be an objective is to get credit available to consumers, whether that's mortgages, credit cards, auto loans, et cetera. It's one of the primary focuses because, as we all know, the securitization markets, the secondary and capital markets, are essentially a frozen tundra right now where capital is simply not available to the banks in that secondary market, which if the banks don't have that credit available, they can't lend it, again, to consumers. So I do think there was a very fine focus by Secretary Paulson to get the securitization markets resumed, to get them going again, so that we will, banks will have capital to lend to consumers, so that they'll have an ability to refinance, so they'll have the ability to borrow to buy a car, so that they'll have an ability to use their credit card at reasonable rates. By invigorating that market, by invigorating the securitization market, it will allow the economy to get back on its feet and resume as normal.
Professor Barr, I want to ask you, do you think Treasury is justified in diverting its attention away from mortgages and towards other urgent needs, such as credit card defaults?
I think there are growing problems throughout the credit markets, including in the markets that Secretary Paulson identified. But I don't think that it's either appropriate or justified to move attention away from the origins of this crisis, as Professor Sanders suggested, in the mortgage markets. We do need to deal with troubled home mortgages. We need an aggressive, robust plan. They can do actions now under their existing authorities. They can take further steps by clarifying tax rules and accounting rules. And I think that's absolutely essential if we're going to get out of the current crisis.
Well, let's look at where we are right now. And I'd like your responses, what you think Congress should do. And anyone else wants to jump in here as I ask my final question of this round, you can feel free to. After today, this administration has only 65 days remaining. If the President asks for the next installment of $350 billion for the Troubled Asset Relief Program, that's the TARP, should Congress give it to him or wait until a new administration has had the opportunity to reconsider Secretary Paulson's decision not to buy mortgage assets with the Troubled Asset Relief?
Mr. Congressman, Mr. Chairman, I think that if the Treasury insists on its current path and refuses to implement a program of the kind that has been described by this panel with respect to buying not the mortgage-backed securities, but mortgages themselves that can be remodified, if Treasury continues to block the FDIC's plan for a guarantee program, my own judgment is it would be inappropriate to proceed with the additional funding.
Anyone else want to jump in on that question before I go to Mr. Issa? Anyone else want to respond?
I would say that it is urgent that TARP use the funds that were authorized to get the market resuscitated as soon as possible. And I think it's imperative for government, both the administration and Congress, to find a way for that to be spent to reinvigorate the market.
Anyone else? Mr. Sanders?
Yeah, I just wanted to, again, go back to the root cause issue, that we have to get to the root cause issue as fast and as expediently as possible. Delays are going to kill us. Where housing prices are not slowing down. I know people like to think they are. They're not. They keep falling. Defaults are increasing dramatically. What we could do, at least in the short run during the current administration, is go into a dramatic loan modification. We can even modify zip codes in states. We can prioritize them. We can go hit some of the cities up in the Northeast. We can go out to some of the places in California. I have maps of all the hot spots of where the foreclosures are the largest. And you ought to see it. It's very compelling.
Well, I've seen it. I live in Cleveland.
Sure,
we know all about it there.
And California is also one of the
ground
zeros.
Well, we also know what's going on with the Alt-A in California. We're concerned coast to coast here. Mr. Kuttenholt, did you have something you wanted to add? And thank you, Professor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was just going to agree with the panel that provided that any systemic risks are addressed, that the most important priority in the recovery is to find a floor and stabilize home price values.
Thank you. We're now going to go for a 10-minute round of questions to Mr. Issa. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I'm going to continue, as we have all day, along pretty much your line of questioning, but maybe expand it a little bit. You know, there, a long time ago, here somebody said, you know, a billion here, a billion there, pretty soon it's real money. I guess we're talking a trillion here and a trillion there, and pretty soon it'll be real money. Mr. Deutsch, I'm a little concerned. $350 billion in the old days used to be real money after you put that many billions together. If we allow this administration in the last 65 days to continue down the same course they're going, in other words, $350 billion more to buy investments in American Express, GMAC, other things that become banks, because they're all becoming banks, because that's the in thing, it's in fashion. Do you believe that that urgency of 65 days preempts the consideration by the new administration of alternate ways to spend that rather relatively small amount of money, $350 billion?
I think there is an urgent need to get the TARP money into the market. I think there's different variations on how that can get into the market, and I don't think we're here today to provide an opinion on exactly how that should be put into the market, but we have identified there's a number of ways that can it can get into the market to not only restore pricing within securitization and particularly mortgage back, but also a way to meet the objectives of the foreclosure standards as well of the bill.
Okay. And before I get into sort of the housing portion of this, I just want to ask one question, realizing you're all very well educated, but you're not Goldman Sachs folks like the last gentleman we had here. But I still want to ask this. If you're going to price preferred stock, a debt slash equity instrument, and you buy it behind closed doors at a relatively low return rate, and it's not floated in the market, how would any of you know that you're paying a fair value? I mean, I would settle for no one would possibly know, but I'll take an attempt at an answer. Please, Professor.
Well, since everyone's pointing to me on this, I'll be glad to try to answer that. And the answer is I agree with you 100%. The markets are so illiquid right now. We have no clue what these things are worth. The CDO market, as you're aware, has completely failed. We don't know how to price those. So I think we'll call it a heroic effort if they think they can go through and price these things appropriately. The only thing I'll say is if they go in and try to buy the loans off the books or give preferred stock or debt, it will be mispriced. But knowing the way this whole thing works, they'll overpay rather than underpay.
Yeah, that's you know, when I couldn't get an answer as to whether the since the credit markets had improved, whether we'd gotten back to par, I think that said a lot today. Let me go through a line of questioning, because I think it may lead this committee and hopefully the rest of the Congress as they review this to some thoughts for not just the $350 billion, but the clearly large amount of money that either directly or indirectly is going to be invested in the next Congress in stabilizing home prices. You know, I keep hearing that you can't actually get to these instruments and buy them out. Okay, that's I heard it here just a minute ago. Mr. Litton, you're probably the best one to handle this. If a house burns down, don't you have to find out who you're going to give the money to?
Yeah, so let me give you a brief description of how we go about working out these loans, right?
Well, no. I don't want that. Okay. I really want this. Look, a house that's within your servicing burns down.
Yep.
And let's assume for a moment it was leased land. So you've 100% loss, and the insurance company says, we know that there's a mortgage on it for $300,000,
right?
But there's $80,000 we're going to pay to on this liquidated asset because that's what it's insured for. You've got an $80,000 check. You've got a $300,000 loan. Do you know where to send that? That check doesn't just sit in a deposit account,
nope.
Doesn't it go?
We actually file a claim with the insurance company. Check comes in, and then we would remit that check as a remittance through to the investor or mortgage-backed security.
Okay.
That is the owner of that asset.
Okay. So taking a piece of that asset and liquidating it, you don't have to go find a guy in Abu Dhabi or the sovereign wealth fund of China. You in fact can start at the home that is underwater and you can liquidate it, because it happens if there's a fire, right?
Right.
You know, Mr. Kucinich and I 18 months ago discovered there was a mass fire in Cleveland, because we're watching boards go on top of homes and they're going nowhere. People are thrown out, the homes are boarded up, and they're sitting there, and of course the neighbor's house goes upside down in value. Ms. Cohen, you've worked in the community for a long time. Let me just ask you a question that, again, is a little off of the main, but I think it's germane. A road is going through a house, and they tell people, I'm sorry, but you got to go, and here's what your house is worth. The city tells you that. Your house and your neighbor's house is worth this amount. They take the house by eminent domain, and they give you X amount of dollars, right? And I assume, like a fire, Mr. Litton would know where to send the check to, even if the check was for less than the loan, right?
Is your question who gets the check?
No, Mr. Litton already took care of who gets the check. But the you know, a city comes in and just takes your house, and it turns out that their value is less than you owe on it. So it all goes to Mr. Litton, and he sends it off to Abu Dhabi. That part we understand. We know where the check goes. But cities do that regularly in blighted communities. They do it in a number of different reasons for redevelopment, right?
Well, it's required under the Constitution's takings clause.
Right. So for us here on the dais, if we began anew looking at how to deal with blighted homes, upside-down situations, people who could pay the current fair market price of a home, either theirs or the one two doors down that's boarded up in the case of many of the homes in Cleveland, the fact is we could empower the cities with money to do this, to take those homes on an individual basis, to allow them to figure out where they're going to stabilize their prices the most. We could do that through existing sub-government bodies, and we could do it with funds that ultimately we'd get substantial amounts back, couldn't we? And isn't that somewhat what we've done over the years from the federal government when we're trying to help communities stabilize prices?
I think that's part of the goal of the Neighborhood Stabilization Program and other programs, where essentially they're trying to make affordable housing out of foreclosed properties. But to the extent that there are homeowners who are in homes that are their primary residences and they can make reasonable payments on the home, we should give them a shot at that first before we move on to the other plan.
Of course. So when we look at this $350 billion, and I'm somebody who lobbied my colleagues and was happy when I could get my colleagues, the majority of them, to vote against the TARP, because I thought it was ill-conceived. Now Secretary Paulson agrees with us. He's decided that his fire-ready aim plan, he's not going to do that firing, but he now is doing other things. I guess the question is, do any of you see that going to the end result, the community, as Professor Sanders says, the community is most blighted, Stockton, California, Las Vegas, Nevada, Cleveland, Ohio, Detroit, Michigan, we can go city by city, that going to those cities and the individuals who could pay, will pay, and dealing with them first, does anyone see that that wouldn't be an every bit as good use of the $350 billion that's remaining? Because that's what Mr. Kucinich and I are here to talk about today.
Well,
yes, Mr. Litton.
Yeah, just to give you some feedback on that, the chairman referenced our relationship with the Eastside Organization Project, which is a classic example of a relationship that works, and it works very well. The members of that community feel comfortable working with that group. They act as the intermediary in many instances between the consumer and ourselves, and we do a lot of workouts through them. So dollars that are spent to help expand the reach of those local groups where there's alignment between the community, these are people that live in the community, they care about what happens in those communities. Those have been very effective relationships that we've been able to lever into getting more deals done. So I can tell you that there are perfect models where that works, and it works very, very well.
Okay. My final question, and it's an important one. During the bubble, we ran up the prices of homes beyond what would have been their normal credit value. Given a normalized credit, the bubble would not have given us home prices as high as it has. I understand the first panel, you know, told us that, you know, we need to shore up these markets. Can any of you, or have you begun to model what the fair value in a normalized credit market is of home values and whether or not the Congress needs to look at that. Because, and my question is simply, in some cases, do we have to go further down against normal credit and ultimately need to let that happen? And in other cases, we are already below the fair value, and many areas of Cleveland fit that examination, or is that they have gotten too low. Is that a factor that we can analyze, and if so, who should help us do it?
What I would suggest on that is that a normalized value for the housing market, I think, would be values that would prevail in an environment where we had normalized mortgage lending and where we had mortgage lending being made under conservative standards with full documentation of income, with loan products that do not include rate shock features. If the mortgage markets were restored and were lending anew under conservative parameters, having learned the lessons of the last several years and maintained those standards, then I think that would over time bring the market values back to a normalized level.
I would just add that one of the key problems now is that foreclosures and defaults and the frozen credit markets are so dramatically pushing down home values nationally and then even further in some areas that it's not a question of reaching bottom. In other words, we'll keep going down. It's a self-reinforcing cycle of credit decline, credit freezing, foreclosures and defaults. You don't break that cycle unless you have a major initiative to stabilize the credit markets. And so I don't think we're going to reach bottom in a natural state unless we take some rather bold action.
Ladies first. Please.
I just want to highlight how your question fits in with a couple of other pieces. One is a lot of borrowers got loans with inflated appraisals. And so notwithstanding the decrease in housing values, and by the way, in East St. Louis and in other places, there was not a hugely inflated home market to begin with. We're talking about homes that are worth $10,000 or $20,000 or $50,000 or $60,000. But many of those folks all over the country, even in California where things were already expensive, got inflated appraisals. And so that's sort of another piece of figuring out how the loan piece fits with the value piece. And then the other point I just want to make is that to the extent that loan modifications are premised on an analysis of net present value, your question about where we are in the market and how do we measure what the value of a home is a present question in that context. And we really have to figure out what do we mean by net present value. And how do we figure that out? Is it based on foreclosure sales? It used to be based on a percentage of the value of the home. But if we don't know how to value the home, we might need to look at another way to do that. And Treasury and everyone else engaged in net present value analyses needs to be more transparent about how they're doing it.
I'm shocked that you would suggest that we should get transparency out of the Treasury. But I appreciate your asking for it as this committee has been asking for it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And I want to
Can I just add one clarifying comment?
I'm sorry. Gentleman second.
Mr. Issa, in terms of housing value, until we actually get lending back in the markets, I don't know where we're going to see the bottom of this. And so until Mr. Paulson and Mr. Kashkari can give us some degree of confidence when liquidity is returning, that would be great. Also, and the other reason why it's difficult to price is that you pointed out yourself, we don't even know what the preferred stock values are. So it's kind of hard to find the bottom of the housing market because nothing's being priced correctly. But one thing I do want to say about TARP, in a perfect world, know who I would like to stick the cost of this to? The banks and the ABS holders. They went through and bought subprime mortgages. They went through and bought these knowing there was a probability this whole thing was going to melt down. Then suddenly we find out, well, we knew all along, from Mr. Kuttenholt that there's problems with getting ABS holders to accept modifications, even if it's in their best interest. And then we're also saying that maybe should we make the banks do this? Well, it turns out we're giving the banks preferred stock, and at the same time we're not making them modify the loans that perhaps they should have done, knowing what the risks were when they went into this market in the first place. So it's this kind of unwinding this is very difficult because there's so many competing problems and competing objectives and competing solutions that I think, unfortunately, we are to the point where we probably will have to use some taxpayer dollars. But I wish we could unbundle the ABS and get them to start, you know, really telling them, hey, look, you bought this, you should modify this, and you help us save the economy, and same to the banks. And that wouldn't cost taxpayers a cent. That's really what I would like to say. I don't know if we can achieve that anymore.
Thank you. Thanks again, Mr. Chairman.
You know, which raises, you know, some of the questions that you, Mr. Issa, have been looking at, and that is, Professor points out that there's a point at which the government does have to intervene. There are those of us who, when we began this discussion about the Troubled Asset Relief Program, we thought, well, you know what, government's interfering in the market here, picking winners and losers, and we're looking at a sea change that we are still finding out what it means. We just don't know yet what it means. We do know, for example, in Cleveland, yes, National City Bank, they were in trouble because, you know, the CEO made a decision to go into subprime loans. And, you know, National City was a blue chip bank at one point. It's a 160-year-old plus bank. And yet it made some bad decisions, okay? Even with that, could have been saved. Even with that. So a decision was made, point that you made. You know, imagine if they would have given that money instead of giving it to PNC, given it to National City Bank. They could have saved the bank. I pointed out that they apparently weren't mindful of the fact that, you know, let's face it, Wall Street, there's a battle going on about for dominance in banking. Banks are eating banks. And now they're using the TARP to take over banks. There's consolidation going on. I mean, that seldom gets discussed about the competition that's still going on. National City, short selling attack, undervaluation of assets, of their stock, over assessment of their debt, credit agencies, which we saw how political they are, weighing in, just as credit agencies are weighing in right now, knocking down the auto suppliers, weakening the auto industry a little bit. You know, there's another level of predatory conduct going on here, which goes back to your point about, you know, if the Treasury is picking these winners and losers, we're in trouble if you can't really establish a ground of meaning as to what anything is worth. And I think that this question of value that was pointed out that you've been, you know, hammering at, Mr. Issa, and that has been talked about by the panel here, I want to go back to Cleveland, Ohio. Our homes weren't overvalued there to begin with. We didn't really see in the city any kind of a boom of housing bubble, let's say. We didn't see that at all. But the bursting of the bubble has affected us, and a subprime wave has affected us. So you have homes in the city and in some of the suburbs where the property values have dropped 25-30%. This is a real loss. I mean, people, for most Americans, they're only investment. So the market manipulation with the subprime, with the 600 trillion plus in these derivatives, is coming home to roost in middle America, and we're seeing a massive transfer of wealth, just massive transfer of wealth. And the government now is apparently presiding over it and helping the banks do it. This is my concern. Now, you know, Mr. Litton, Secretary Paulson apparently left foreclosure mitigation to private industry. Recently, the industry put out a protocol that looks something like what you've been doing for years. Do you think, based on your experience, that such initiatives will be enough to stem the foreclosure crisis?
Okay, so here is one of the challenges with our industry, with the company that I run. The vast majority of the pooling and servicing agreements gives me wide latitude on being able to operate within doing these loan modifications. There's other servicers that don't have quite that same latitude, so that is a problem. I can tell you as an asset manager that if I did not have that latitude, then the losses that I would be presiding over as it relates to trying to administer defaults on these loans would be a lot higher than they are today. So I think that that is a significant obstacle and a significant problem that has to be dealt with.
What's the obstacle?
The obstacle is that there's some pooling and servicing agreements that don't provide the wide latitude that servicers like a Litton or others may have. Because of the inconsistency of those pooling and servicing agreements, it creates obstacles from servicers being able to execute that. I think that is a problem.
Would you comment on a target of the 38% debt to income that is a cornerstone of the streamlined modification program issued by Hope Now?
Absolutely. From my perspective, when I look at our recent performance, I look at all the loan modifications we did in the last year, 41,000. I look at the redefault rates, which are now north of 40% and going up dramatically. When I look at that 38% debt to income standard, which has been our average income to debt rate standard, what that clearly tells me is that even though we're doing more loan modifications, the loan modifications are not as effective as they need to be. It also tells me that we need to lower the debt to income standard so that we can provide a longer term sustainable mortgage. I think doing that is consistent with my obligation under the terms of the pooling and servicing agreements, in which I'll create lower losses for investors at the end of the day. But a 38% standard, in my judgment, based off of performance that I've looked at in my book, will not be as effective as a 31% standard that produces a lower monthly payment for these borrowers.
So what's the role of principal reduction and sustainability of a loan?
So from a principal reduction perspective, as we've analyzed this issue, we believe that more principal reductions need to occur. Here's the reason why, is that servicers, when we service loans on a day-to-day basis, we make decisions every single day to write off principal. When we sell a piece of real estate that's been foreclosed on, that is a determination that I as a servicer have to make, taking into account property value and other things, to sell that piece of property and take a principal reduction. When I do a short sale, it's the same type of an analysis. Our pooling and servicing agreements gives us wide latitude to waive principal when we need to. So we will waive principal, which resets the loan balance at a more reasonable level. We believe using a market-based note rate, waiving principal creates a longer-term affordable mortgage, because right now, leaving that balance out there and rolling it forward is going to make it much more difficult for that borrower to pay that loan off in the future. If this was going to be a V-shaped recovery and property values were going to recover next year, we would want to forbear principal. But nothing in the card seems to indicate that that is the case. So waiving more principal more aggressively, I think, is the appropriate response given the conditions that we're facing today. Chairman.
I guess the question whether the recovery is V or Z.
Good point, sir.
Mr. Litton, what assumptions do you have about the future of the housing market that strike that? I'm going to go to Mr. Deutsch.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Deutsch, you've heard other witnesses say that loan modifications, emphasizing principal modifications, are needed to restore financial certainty and to keep borrowers in their homes. What I would like you to comment on is this. Do you think, left on its own, private industry will perform that kind of modification program? And if not, what might that say about the role the federal government should perform? Mr. Deutsch.
Well, let me start with the programs that are out there. Nearly every loan modification program, including IndyMac through the FDIC's program, Countrywide program, the Chase program, the Citibank program, each and every one of those programs focuses on interest rate modifications and principal forbearance as the initial steps, as the first things to look at to be able to get to an ability to pay for each of those borrowers. That is, and is included in my testimony as Annex A, is that interest rate modifications can get most borrowers to a point where they have the ability to pay their mortgage. Some, whether it's a Jose Canseco in California or others, who choose to walk away from their homes, who choose to walk away from their obligations, some of those simply can't be prevented. None of us can require or want Jose Canseco to stay in those homes that are underwater. Now, it's very clear that in certain circumstances, in appropriate circumstances, that principal modifications can, will be, and as Mr. Litton has said, have been made. but I think those will continue to be used in limited circumstances. It does say, to the second part of your question, what is the role, if any, of the government? I think we've outlined two ways that can encourage principal reductions. First, through purchasing loans out at subpar prices, that is, and servicers acting on behalf of investors could sell loans out of the pool potentially after a number of hurdles could be cleared. To the TARP program. Those would not be sold at 100% of the value. They would be sold at something below 100% of the value, depending on the delinquency default probabilities. So I think ultimately, and as well as the program announced this morning by the FDIC chairman, it's looking to take advantage of providing incentives to be able to have servicers modify these loans into programs, to refinance them into the programs like the Hope for Homeowners. But I do think those take modifications and a lot of analysis onto the detail.
I want to thank you very much for that response. We're at the conclusion of the hearing. I would just say that your response and the other witnesses indicates that Secretary Paulson should be rethinking his decision about the use of TARP funds with respect to loan modification. Would you agree with that?
I think there's a lot of opportunity to help reduce foreclosures through the use of TARP funds.
Mr. Kuttenholt.
Yeah, I agree. I think that program should be initiated, as we discussed, to help reduce foreclosures.
It's clear that we need to do more sustainable loan modifications. I think that's absolutely, sir.
The government can do a lot for loan modifications, and they can also allow the private sector and courts to do more with bankruptcy reform.
Thank you. Professor Sanders.
And I agree with everything, but I also want to point out that we do mark-to-market for mortgage-backed securities, ABS, CDOs, but the one person or set of groups we don't do mark-to-market for is homeowners. If we mark their loans to market, we wouldn't be having a default wave.
Right. Thank you, Professor. Professor Barr, finally.
Yes, I think we need to start quickly with the change to the tax and accounting rules to unlock these securitization trusts. And then we can proceed with a systematic modification program using the guarantee authority and the Treasury purchase program has been described. I think it would make an enormous difference.
I want to thank each and every one of the witnesses. Our staff will continue to be in touch with you as this matter continues to be not just in discussion, but vexing the Congress as far as what to do. Your testimony today shows a path. And it was very thoughtful testimony, each and every one of you. Are much appreciated for your presentation here today, and we ask that you feel free to communicate with our subcommittee with respect to any other observations you have as we proceed. We certainly have to find a way to help keep people in their homes. And as you pointed out, you're looking at principal, at loan modifications, and which include principal, interest, arrearages, and a rescheduling of the debt. So thank you. Because you give hope to millions of Americans who are looking for a new direction. This is the Domestic Policy Subcommittee. I'm Congressman Dennis Kucinich from Cleveland, Ohio, the chairman of the committee. Today's discussion has been on this question. Is Treasury using bailout funds to increase foreclosure prevention, as Congress intended? We've had witnesses who have included Mr. Neil Kashkari, the Interim Assistant Secretary of the Treasury for Financial Stability, and Assistant Secretary of the Treasury for International Economics and Development, and we much appreciate his participation today, as well as the second panel, Professor Michael Barr, Professor Anthony Sanders, Ms. Elise Cohen, Mr. Stephen Kuttenholt, Mr. Larry Litton, and Mr. Thomas Deutsch. Thanks to you for being here. Thanks to the staff for the excellent work they've done in preparing members for this. And thanks to my partner, Mr. Issa, for his tremendous participation. This committee stands adjourned. Thank you.